For this topic, we are going to look at the difference between the inverse function and the reciprocal function. And we're going to start with this linear function as our model function. There is a warning, you can't always find an inverse function. There has to be certain conditions that exist to find those inverse functions. This one is invertible, so we're not going to have any of those things to work around in this, because I want to really focus on the difference between inverse and reciprocal. So the reciprocal function is the easier of the two to find. We're going to do that one last. The first one we're going to do is we're going to find the inverse function, and there are several steps in doing that. All right, the first step is we are going to replace the f of x, the function notation, with a y. It's a lot easier to manipulate this with a y in here. So we are doing ourselves a favor by doing this replacement. And then the second step is I'm going to swap the x's and the y's. Everywhere you see a y, you'll replace it with an x. Everywhere you see an x, you replace it with a y. So we are swapping those two variables. X's and the y's, so we had a y here, it becomes an x. We have an x here, it becomes a y. So that is our second step, switching x's and y's. And then the third step is we're going to solve this for y again. So solving for y, you're just going to use all of your typical problem-solving techniques. We have the 12 that we're going to move to the other side. So since this is positive, we're going to subtract 12 from both sides. So we'll get x minus 12, and that's equal to 3y, and then divide both sides by 3. So we're going to end up with x thirds minus 4 equals y. So this is our solved for y here. And then the fourth step is we're going to replace this y with the inverse function notation. All right, so this is our inverse function. We have f inverse of x equals x divided by 3 minus 4. And you can check this in a couple of different ways. You can check it point by point by substituting in points. So whatever your x was here is going to be your y value here. Whatever your y value was here is going to be an x value here. And this should be a true statement. That's point by point. Of course, that's not the best way to prove something. We want to prove something all the time, every time, for all possible values. So to do that kind of specific once for all type of proof, you're going to compose the original function with this function. And if you get just the independent variable back and nothing else, then you have demonstrated that you have an inverse function. All right, so now for the easier route, we are going to look at the reciprocal function. Okay, so finding the reciprocal, we are looking for some function that is of the form of 1 over the function that we started with. And sometimes this feels like a trick to students because they think, is it really that easy? Do I just write the thing that I was given as the denominator with 1, so I create a unit fraction out of my function? That's exactly how easy it is. So if I want the inverse of this, it's going to be some other function, possibly. But it's we use g of x in the demonstration. I'll use g of x here. So we're going to say that the function we're looking for is going to be this. We've just simply taken this and written it in the denominator. Is this a function? Well, you can do all the usual tests. Vertical line test is the common one they talk about. Graph this and do a vertical line test. You will see that there is a domain limitation here that you didn't have in the original one, because you've now introduced your independent variable into the denominator, and so there's got to be some x value that's not going to be allowed here, and that's going to limit your y. So there's an asymptote that's going to be involved in here, but this is what we're looking for when we're looking for a reciprocal function. It's the original function written as a unit fraction. Hopefully this has been helpful. Cheerful Calculations.